Your scripture this morning is taken from Exodus 6th chapter 28, or I'm sorry, Exodus 6, 28th chapter 7. I see. Now when the Lord spoke to Moses in Egypt, he said to him, I am the Lord. Tell Pharaoh, king of Egypt, everything that I tell you. But Moses said to the Lord, since I speak with faltering lips, why would Pharaoh listen to me? Then the Lord said to Moses, see, I have made you like God to Pharaoh, and your brother Aaron will be your prophet. You're to say everything I command you, and your brother Aaron is to tell Pharaoh to tell the Israelites to let the Israelites go out of his country. But I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and though I multiply my signs and wonders in Egypt, he will not listen to you. Then I will lay my hand on Egypt, and with mighty acts of judgment, I will bring out my divisions, my people, the Israelites. And the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I stretch out my hand against Egypt and bring the Israelites out of it. Moses and Aaron did just as the Lord commanded them. Moses was 80 years old, and Aaron 83 when they spoke to Pharaoh.
Know that God is God? How do you know that God is God? We were at Catalyst Conference this past week, and in the evening session, they usually take a couple hours, and they really try and just cut to the core of who you are, really. Through worship, through an impactful message, and the organizer of Catalyst, the guy in charge now, his name is Tyler Reagan, excellent name. He's talking to the crowd, and we're 7,500 people in this room, and he's addressing the crowd, and he's talking about some of the things that are going on in our world right now, and the brokenness, and the hurt, and all this stuff. And he starts just really kind of getting into it and talking about how he felt that God has kind of impressed upon him on his heart that evening and that afternoon this idea of being set free, and how there are many of us who just we need to acknowledge, we need to turn over, we need to give to Christ, because who the Son sets free is free indeed. And so he goes into this, prays about it, it's just great. And then the worship team comes on. And at Catalyst this year, the evening worship was led by Hillsong Worship, and they're pretty much responsible for about a third of the contemporary worship music that's available over the last 20 years. It's an incredible group from Australia, big church down there that writes and does all this stuff. Well, they're performing their music, and they get a couple songs into their set list, and they said, we were talking with Tyler backstage this afternoon, and kind of going over what this evening would look like and those types of things. And they said he was sharing his heart about how he felt like this theme of being set free was really where God wanted to take the evening. And we're going to do something that we don't do. We're going to do something that we never do, in fact. We're going to perform a song here for you in Atlanta that we haven't even tried out at our church yet. It's not on any record. It's not produced or anything yet. It's one that our church hasn't even heard. And they began to sing this song dealing with being set free. Incredible. They just had that in the back of their pocket. Some might say that's just a coincidence, you know, that God is putting it on Tyler's heart. This band has traveled from Australia to be here, and it just so happens that they have this song that they want to perform that matches up with what God is leading him with. It's just coincidence. Now, I have a different idea about, a different approach, a different understanding of coincidence. Now, not all coincidence is this, but I think some, a large portion is, I think that coincidence is often a consequence of God's compassion. Coincidence is often a consequence of God's compassion. I'm a preacher, so we start things with the same letter because it's easier to remember. Sometimes when coincidences happen, I think they are God's way of suddenly nudging you and saying, I'm here. I care. Pay attention. Sometimes coincidence is just that. It's random things that happen for no rhyme or reason. It just sort of lines up, right? I mean, you can't go, somebody's hungry. Oh, it just so happens there's a McDonald's down the street. Therefore, it must be God. Or, I'm in a hurry today, and this little old man in a scooter is in a parking spot at Walmart, and my car just barely fits between his scooter and the car in the next, and I knocked it over, but it's okay. It must be God. Speak now. You can't go crazy with this idea, but I think oftentimes, coincidence is a consequence of God's compassion for you and for me. So we're going to explore this idea of coincidence, but we're also going to look at how sometimes we ignore those coincidences. Sometimes we write them off. We harden our hearts and we write them off as just random and incidental. They have no real rhyme or reason. It's just how it happened, just how it happened to be. So the question that you can write down or ponder or think about or pray about is, what is hardening my heart? Or what is hardening your heart? What is hardening our heart? What is hardening my heart? There are a few things that we can learn from this text. I'm going to preach from my phone today because I was gone. And while the Gideons were very helpful, I'm reading through the text and it says, and the Lord spake. I have never spake anything. And so I decided I would use my phone instead of the King James that the Gideons provide. But I do appreciate their ministry. We're going to be in Exodus. Everybody say Exodus.
Exodus.
Exodus, chapter 6, verse 28, into chapter 7. We're going to go through verse 7. So if you have a Bible, and I know you do, I'd encourage you to go there. Otherwise, feel free to listen to my ramblings, and we'll try and connect and make it happen. Exodus, chapter 6, verse 28. So what hardens our heart? One of the things that hardens our heart, and hardens a lot of people's hearts, is this, our past. Our past. Let me read verse 28 through 30. It says, now when the Lord spoke to Moses in Egypt, he said to him, I am the Lord. Tell Pharaoh, king of Egypt, everything that I tell you. But Moses said to the Lord, since I speak with faltering lips, why would Pharaoh listen to me? Now, if you were here last week, that sounds very familiar. In fact, in the text, this conversation is repeated. There's a little break from the text that we ended with last week, early chapter 6. Then there's a break where they go through a genealogy, which, yes, we skipped, but you can read through your bulletin and read through the text and enjoy that. And then you get back up here to verse 28 at the end of chapter 6, and the conversation is repeated. It's like, here's what happened. Quick little break to fill you in on some interesting tidbits. Last time, on Moses and Aaron speak to God. And they have this recap. God says, here's what I want you to do. Go talk to Pharaoh. I am the Lord. And Moses says, I can't. I have faltering lips, he says. Moses has this way of going back. And actually, if you look at that, the first instance of this conversation, it says, if the Israelites
didn't listen to me.
Then why would Pharaoh listen to me? Because I can't talk good. We have this way of something happens, and say we make a mistake, or we break something, or we fail at something, and it haunts us. We allow it to follow us. We carry it like luggage through the airport everywhere we go in our life. And it prevents us from seeing anything except that one mistake. Or maybe other people have a way of bringing that up all the time. Yeah, I'm sure you've changed, but do you remember when? Or you get in a fight with your spouse, I'm sure I'm the only one. And we just have arguments or discussions, I mean. You have a discussion with your spouse and you're talking about things and all of a sudden all this stuff is drug up from the depths. Or maybe it's something that someone did to you. Maybe there was an abusive situation. Maybe there was a betrayal. Maybe there was a lie that was told, a hurt that was inflicted, and in some way, some form or fashion, it hurts, and it hardens, and it is the only thing that you can see. See, God is pretty patient with Moses. I don't know if you've been paying attention in the last few weeks as we've been going through Exodus. He's pretty patient with Moses. I mean, Moses had this whole conversation with God. God, I can't. God, I can't. God, I can't. Here's my PowerPoint presentation of all the reasons why I can't be the guy that you need. God says, I don't care. I'm God. Let's go. And Moses is still carrying that around. God, I can't because they didn't listen, because it didn't work, because it didn't fit my timeline, because of my own faults, failures, and insecurities. We have a way of letting our past harden our hearts. I want to take you to verse 1 of chapter 7 now. The Lord said to Moses, see, I have made you like God to Pharaoh, and your brother Aaron will be your prophet. I've made you like God. Like me, God has said. He said, look, Pharaoh is not going to see this stuttering, stammering, broken, small individual. He is going to see me, God Almighty, the I am that I am. You are going to be like God to Pharaoh. You are my ambassador. You will be representative of me to this ruler, and Aaron, your brother, is going to be like a prophet, speaking the word of the Lord. By the way, this is just my own personal TD. Aaron is supposed to be the mouthpiece, the microphone, the one that's doing all the talking. Have you noticed so far he hasn't said a word in the text? I just find that funny. Anyway. So God says, look, this is how it's going to be. You are going to be like me, like God. So long as your heart is soft, as long as your heart is open to it. This year at Catalyst, we had the opportunity and the privilege, really, at the very last session, Andy Stanley interviewed Bill Hybels. Bill is the founding pastor, the senior pastor of Willow Creek Community Church, which there's all sorts of things Willow Creek has done, but it's this massive, massive outreach-driven church. And Andy is interviewing Bill. They're good friends. They're just talking about leadership stuff. And it's one of those things. It's kind of like you climb up the mountain to see the sage sitting in his orange robe, you know, and he lets out a couple sentences, and you're like, oh, I didn't understand that, but I think it's good. Bill Hybels said this. He said, if your heart is soft towards God's whispers and people's pain, then God can use you. If your heart is soft towards God's whispers and people's pain, then God can use you. I don't know about you, but I've been finding it really, really hard to be sympathetic lately. Anybody else? I mean, sure, we have global tragedies, and we have this stuff, and we're like, oh, that's awful, oh, that's terrible, oh, the destruction, but then you get online, and people ramble and rant and this and that, and all of that, and you're like, you start just kind of glazing over it, you start ignoring it, you start becoming apathetic towards it, and you start hardening a bit. This week is about being of good courage, taking courage, and part of the way that we take courage is when God calls you into a scary place, a darkened room, an unknown situation, you do it scared, as they mentioned. You move forward anyway. But if I'm ignoring God's whispers, then I go, that's a dark room, I don't want to go in, and I'm going to find something else to do. If your heart is soft towards God's whispers, people's pain, then God can use you. Brandon Heath wrote a song a few years back called Give Me Your Eyes. And the chorus goes something like this. It says, give me your eyes for just one second. Give me your eyes so I can see. Everything that I've been missing, give me your love for humanity. Give me your heart for the brokenhearted. Give me your arms so I can reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Maybe for some of us that needs to be our prayer. We've let our past, our criticisms, our cynicisms, our nature, our experiences make us bitter, make us cold, make us apathetic towards the hurts around us. And our heart has been harder. So, Greg Bainheim gets a text invitation, a notification every morning at 7:14.
And every night
at 7:14, different ones. And for Friday morning, he gets one at 7:14. We were already at the conference because, hey, I like to be there early. He gets it at the conference, and it says something to the effect of, don't let the bride of Christ be contaminated by something that's going to take God's place. Don't let the bride of Christ, the church, of course, don't let the bride of Christ be influenced, be affected dramatically by something that is trying to take God's place. Our first speaker on Friday morning was a woman named Christine Kane. And if you've never heard Christine speak, she is a spark plug. She is just smack you in the face and pat you on the back and hug you and yell at you. It's an experience. And one of the things that she said about how we should treat each other and how we should get along, she's talking, she said, maybe we should stop talking bad about the bride of Christ. She says, if I were up on my wedding day, and my husband's standing on the stage, and I come down the aisle in my dress, and his best man leans over and says, wow, she's ugly. My husband would have decked him. How often do we point out the pockmarks on God's bride? Now, I'm sure it's just coincidence that Friday morning, Greg gets a notification like he always does. And this particular one happened to reference language, Bride of Christ, which is only referenced a few times in the Bible. And that our very first speaker on Friday morning her talk had to deal with how we treat Christ's bride. I'm sure it's just coincidence. So the second thing that can harden our hearts is our pride. Everybody say pride.
Pride.
Everybody say, woohoo!
Woohoo!
And now say, I am awesome.
I am awesome.
You are. Sometimes we get a little too full of ourselves, don't we? I want to take you back to Exodus chapter 7. starting in verse 2, God is still talking to Moses. He says, you're to say everything that I command you, and your brother Aaron is to tell Pharaoh to let the Israelites go out of his country. But I will harden Pharaoh's heart. And though I multiply my signs and wonders in Egypt, he will not listen to you. Then I will lay my hand on Egypt, and with mighty acts of judgment, I will bring out my division to my people, the Israelites. Now, we've glazed over it a bit before, but I want to address it, that phrase, because it's one that comes up when you're reading through Exodus. That phrase, I will harden Pharaoh's heart. And we kind of feel sympathetic towards Pharaoh, like, well, gee whiz, the poor guy didn't have a choice. It seems as though God is like, no, this is how it's going to be.
Okay, I don't agree.
Right? I will harden Pharaoh's heart. And that, as we go through the plagues later on in Exodus, you're all familiar with the story. As we go through that, there are going to be instances in the first bit where it's like, God hardened Pharaoh's heart, God hardened Pharaoh's heart, God hardened Pharaoh's heart, and then Pharaoh hardened his own heart. And we think, whoa, 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 did Pharaoh even have a choice? Did he have a chance? I looked up the word harden in the original language, and it means to be hard, or to be harsh, or to be severe. Essentially, God is telling Moses, look, I'm going to be hard on Pharaoh. This is going to be harsh. This is going to be intense. This is, you know, baptism by fire type stuff. You ever pull tough love on your kids? They weren't a fan of it? See, when we read through the scriptures, the Hebrew scriptures, they are that Hebrew scriptures. We get this side of the story. And while scripture is incredible, 66 books written by 40 different authors on 3 different continents and over thousands of years, we don't have the Egyptian side of things. And you can go back through antiquity and find all that stuff and try and piece together what was happening, but you're probably not going to get Pharaoh's side of the story. You know why? Because a Pharaoh doesn't show weakness. A Pharaoh doesn't express struggle, especially not when it comes to creating huge pictures or memorials or statues. You don't talk about the great Pharaoh of Egypt who had a difficult time deciphering God's will for his life. No. No. The Pharaoh considered himself, I mentioned this a few weeks back, considered himself to be a god. Therefore, his authority was absolute. His reign was total. His power was unmatched in his own mind. So maybe Pharaoh had opportunities. We don't know. Maybe these were Pharaoh's opportunities to turn things around. Maybe Pharaoh dealt with the situation like many of us, like Bruce.
What should I do? Give me a signal. Need your guidance, Lord.
Please, send me a sign.
Oh, what's this Joker doing now? Okay. All right. I'll try your way. All right? Lord, I need a miracle. I need your help, Lord. Please, reach into my life. What the hell are you?
Oh,
give me some direction. Give me something. Show me some writing on the wall. Tell me what I need to do. And everything that happens just seems like an interruption. Disruption. One more thing piled on top. Perhaps something else. Scripture says, even with the signs and wonders that I'm going to perform in Egypt, Pharaoh won't listen. I'll put it right in front of him. It will be so obvious. And yet, he won't listen. His pride will be such that he will keep saying, I can do it on my own. I am king of the world. I don't need anybody's help. But we never say that. We never have any trouble in our lives, right? If you ask everybody when they come to church how they're doing, they'll say, oh, fine. I'm good. Life is grand. Everything is perfect. Some of them might even say out loud, I am awesome. But in reality, something much different is happening beyond behind the scenes. But we just, we're too afraid, too proud to ask for help. Sometimes that's the most courageous thing you can do. And yet we feel like God's signs are just interruptions, disruptions. They hit us again and again and again, and we just don't notice it. It's like a 300-pound lineman charging towards you, knocking you on the ground. So, we had a chance to hear Tim Tebow speak at this year's conference. Tebow is a former NFL player, currently plays minor league for the Mets. A few years back, Adam Schefter, who works with ESPN, he's a senior editor, a senior writer there, he wrote an article January 13th, 2012, and I'm just going to read his words. Tebow told us this story. I got the article from ESPN. It says, there's no need to embellish in this story. Facts speak for themselves. On January 8th, 2009, in the BCS championship game, then Florida Gator quarterback Tim Tebow wore eye black with the inscription John 3:16, a reference to the Bible passage that says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. After that game, 94 million people Googled, what does John 3:16 mean? 94 million people. That was January 8th, 2009. On January 8th, 2012, 3 years to the date that he caused millions of football fans to Google the meaning of John 3:16, Tebow played his first NFL playoff game against the Pittsburgh Steelers. And Tebow threw for 316 yards. Tebow averaged 31.6 yards per completion, the highest single-game postseason completion average in NFL history. Ben Roethlisberger's second-quarter interception, which led to a Matt Prater field goal and a 17-6 Broncos lead, came on 3rd and 16. The Steelers finished the game with a time of possession of 31 minutes and 6 seconds. And at the time Tebow threw the game-winning 80-yard touchdown pass to Demaryius Thomas, the NFL's longest postseason pass in overtime history, CBS's final quarter-hour overnight ratings were, yes, you guessed it, a 31.6. Now, some people believe in UFOs, some don't. Some believe in the afterlife, some don't. Some believe in coincidences, some don't. And some people believe in the power and talents of Tebow, and some don't. But there can be no denying that the events from Denver's wildcard win over Pittsburgh are downright eerie. When this string of 316 facts were relayed to one NFL executive this week, he paused and said, is that right? I'm converting. Probably just a coincidence, though. Just a coincidence. We got two more. I'll try and be quick. The third thing that can harden our hearts is our privilege. Our privilege. Let me take you back to Exodus, verse 5. God says, "And the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I stretch out my hand against Egypt and bring the Israelites out of it." The text that I originally read, thank you to the Gideon, said, "out from among them." The Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I stretch out my hand and bring the Israelites out from among them. Now, there's a lot of different stuff going on here. I'll try and be brief. Has anybody ever gotten something that you felt you deserved? A position, a place, your parking spot, you were clearly signaling to go there, and some child of God sped in with a red Corvette and whipped right in there, cut you off, and took your spot. Or, your favorite snack. Your favorite snack. Like, you would cross the earth for this stuff. Your favorite snack is in the fridge. You know you are going to eat that thing by the night's end. As soon as the child is down or the show is over or whatever, your favorite snack. You've got it in your mind right now. Your favorite snack. Like, it just makes your mouth water anyway. You open the fridge and it's gone. There's about to be some wrath in here. Yeah. So God is going to show up, and the Egyptians will know that he is the Lord when he takes the Israelites, the slaves, the least of these, and brings them out from among the Egyptians. See, the Egyptians, they weren't slaves. They were the home team, right? They were the nation in charge. Their Pharaoh was the conqueror. He had it all planned out. Now, can you imagine? And we're going to experience this in the coming weeks. If all the Egyptians get is pain, heartache, and suffering, and the Israelites, they just get blessing and relief and freedom. I looked up that phrase, "know that I am the Lord," because I just wanted to see. I just wanted to know how often that occurs in Scripture. It occurs 68 times. This is just for the Bible geeks and nerds like me. It occurs 68 times only in the Old Testament. That's interesting. Only in the Old Testament. It occurs 9 times in Exodus. Oftentimes God is saying, "I'm going to do this, and the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord." That whole phrase, "know that I am the Lord." Or he'll say, "the Israelites will know that I am the Lord when I provide them manna to eat." Or, "these people will know that I am the Lord." They will know that I am the Lord. Everybody say that with me. "Know that I am the Lord." And it's one of those things that occurs again and again. 9 times in Exodus. It occurs 54 times in the book of Ezekiel. You've never read the book of Ezekiel. It's a hoot. But in the book of Ezekiel, Ezekiel, who is a no-holds-barred prophet, he is just laying out God's direct message to people. And he says, I thought that was funny when I hit myself. I'm watching you, Lawrence. He says to all of these different nations who are oppressing God's people, "they will know that I am the Lord when." They will know that I am the Lord when this happens, this happens, this happens. They will know that I am the Lord. So when I looked up and "know that I am the Lord," I wanted to look up, well, how often does the phrase "know that I am God" appear? One time. Psalm 46, verse 10. Written by a little shepherd boy, talking about how God is his refuge and his strength, and how he's going to praise him all his days. And in Psalm 46, verse 10, he says, "Be still and know that I am God," says the Lord. Sometimes we let our position, our privilege, our prestige harden our hearts, put blinders over our eyes, and we don't see God. We just see what we deserve or what we're entitled to or what we think we ought to get. And if we would lay all that down and be still, recognize how dependent we are, perhaps our heart would soften a bit. I gotta keep moving, and so I move to the fourth thing that can harden our heart, and it's this, our presbyopia. I know, that's what you were expecting, right? Our presbyopia. Everybody say that with me. Presbyopia. Raise my hand. I'll explain it in a bit. Let me finish the text. Verse 6 and 7. Moses and Aaron did just as the Lord commanded them. Moses was 80 years old, and Aaron, 83, when they spoke to Pharaoh. A reminder that, oh, by the way, these aren't young pups. These are 80 and 83-year-old men. Now, what does that have to do with presbyopia? Well, that's a good question. I'm glad that you asked. So let me explain to you what presbyopia is, in case none of you are doctors. Presbyopia, and this is the definition provided by Mayo Clinic, says when you look at something nearby, the muscles of your eyes constrict, allowing the relatively elastic lens to curve and change its focusing power. Presbyopia is caused by a hardening of the lens of your eye, which occurs with aging. As your lens becomes less flexible, it can no longer change shape to focus on close-up images. To be honest, when I find stuff like that, as a pastor, I'm like, oh, well, I don't even gotta do anything. As we get older, it's hard for us to change shape, isn't it? Hard for us to be flexible, hard for us to see anything different or to recognize how God might be doing something differently. And that can harden our hearts, our spiritual eyes. And as the fine folks at Mayo put it, you'll end up missing things that are right in front of you. Missing the God who is right in front of you. So, this week, we're sitting there, Greg kind of told the story already. One of the MCs is up on stage, trying to do stand-up comedy. It's not going well. I know what that feels like. And a voice from off stage says, well, let me just stop you. Let me show you how it's done, essentially. And Jeff Foxworthy comes out on stage. Now, how many people know who Jeff Foxworthy is? Okay, most of you. All right. Jeff is a Christian, if you don't know, lives in the Atlanta area now. He has run, I assume he still runs, a little local Bible study for some homeless guys, and just does incredible stuff off stage. But this year he got up on stage, he starts going into a segment, if you will, a string of jokes. And in this case, it was telling a story about his colonoscopy. Which I thought was hilarious, because I have the sense of humor of a junior high boy, so let's go with it. Now, the reason I tell you that is to tell you this. Last Christmas, almost a year ago, I didn't know what to get my dad, right? And, you know, at that point, he was just starting to have the back pain and all that stuff, and what am I going to get him? I know what I'll get him. He really likes Jeff Foxworthy, and so I'll get him some of those guys, their DVDs and stuff. That have their comedy sketches and some of those things on it, right? And so one of the DVDs that I got him had Jeff Foxworthy and some other guys, and in that DVD, Jeff talks about his colonoscopy. Now, here's the thing. Dad never got to open his DVD. After he had passed, we're going through everything, figuring out what we want or whatever, and I came across those three DVDs still in their packaging, so I said, I'll take them home. I turned 31. Every year, for as long as I can remember, the first person to wish me a happy birthday was my dad. And so, while many of you and many of my friends wish me happy birthday, and I do appreciate all that, there was still one glaring absence. And out comes Jeff Foxworthy. It was one of those moments where I'm laughing because, let's face it, poop is funny. But I'm also like choked up and crying. Like, it's this combination. I don't know what's happening here, but it's almost as though Dad is saying, I'm here. Coincidences. Sometimes, oftentimes, are a consequence of God's compassion. It's your dad saying, I'm here. So let's harden your heart. I pray, whatever it is, whether it's your past, your pride, your privilege, I invite you. But you and God get together and you start working on some of that. So that your response won't be like the response in Genesis 28. Jacob wakes up from his dream and he says, surely God was in this place and I did not know. Father, this morning, thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for those moments in our lives that we could dismiss as mere coincidence. But perhaps they are an indicator of your love. Perhaps they are your way of saying that you are here with us through the best and the worst of times. May you soften our hearts so that we can be made more aware of your whispers and other people's pain, so that we can be used by you to be like you to a world that desperately, desperately needs you. We thank you for Jesus. It's in his name that we pray.